military-industrial complex that has gone mad, but we have enough money for that, but we don't have enough money to invest in our people so that they can start off their lives living in greatness. Everybody should aspire to live in greatness, and everybody should have the opportunity to live a good life, not a halfway decent life, but a good life to make it worth living. In our revolution, we try our very best to do our part to empower the grassroots. We do that through supporting progressive candidates because we know that we have to have progressives elected who believe in the policies that we're pushing to lift people. We do that by making sure we support progressive issues. A really good example of something that we were very supportive of, along with many other folks taking the lead of the reentry population, was the Second Chance Amendment in Florida, 1.5 million folks re-enfranchised, returning citizens to their communities where their voting rights have been permanently stripped away. And I want to make this final point. It was that population that led the effort, but they had other folks like Our Revolution and other organizations right by their side to make sure that that issue won. We have supported issues all across this country, from a living wage to making sure that people can afford to live in their houses. Many of us know, not just right here in Los Angeles, but also in the Bay Area, I had an opportunity to be there and to walk over people who are living in the streets. I don't know anybody who wants to live in the streets, but when you talk to people being priced out and being able to live in their own communities, there is something wrong with that. So our revolution is fighting, yes we are, to help to form a more perfect union. One elected official at a time, one community at a time, and we do all of that work because of our great groups that we have, everyday grassroots people, trying to make a difference, trying to do, in the words of President Nelson Mandela, make the impossible possible. Mm-hmm. He said it always seems impossible until it is done. Mm-hmm. And we are out there doing it, softening the soil. And I want to thank all of you for being here tonight with us and believing in the work that we do. And with that, I want to introduce one of our illustrious
someone asked him at the time, what have you endured since he's certainly one of the major influences in terms of what ultimately became the atomic bomb was discovered. Someone asked him, what kind of weapons do you think they use in the next war? And Albert Einstein said, I don't know what they're going to use in the next war, but when the next war after that, they'll be using sticks and stones. So we do understand the dangers, but the great possibilities that occur. Countries around the world were free from receiving their independence, from colonialism. You know the war in Vietnam. The Vietnamese defeated the French at Dien Bien Phu in 1954. Brown versus the Board of Education, 1954. Montgomery bus boycott, 1955. Ghana's independence, 1957. Nigeria's independence, 1960, you go on and on and on, and all these kind of new revelations of changing the world that it was changing. But the great line in Visconti's movie, The Lepers, which Lord Lancaster, at the time of the Garibaldi Revolution in the 1840s, this aristocrat was supporting the unification of Italy. And he said a great line, he said, things must change in order to remain the same. Mm-hmm. Profound. When we think about the idea of real change, what does it mean by substantive change? At the same time, since those of us who come up as activists, what does it mean about sustainable activism? And how do we find the intersectionality between issues itself? That's important. To find that, to understand that. King understood it, Dr. King understood what he said. There's three, there's triplets of racism, materialism, and militarism. And he was able to understand that. And he understands the emergence of materialism in a different way. The whole idea there of the American dream. Not an idea around the idea around the effort of inclusiveness, not an idea based upon the commodification of communities and commodification of people. Yeah. In a sense, the whole idea of that, in a sense, was important to understand. We face some very difficult moments. We face the question of whose democracy is this going to be? We've seen what has happened in Latin America, we've seen what is happening around the region, the turns to the right, that it seems as if every former president, whether it's Sister Krishna in Argentina, whether it's Lula in Brazil, whether it's Correa in Ecuador, every former president has some sort of charge on them about their sin. Yet they were ushered in a moment that they didn't create the moment themselves. Mm-hmm. The moment was created from the bottom up, mm-hmm. where people began to reimagine the whole idea of democracy, and the possibilities of electoral democracy in this sense. So we were questioning that as we see this move to this right. And it's important for us to understand the intersectionality between the issues, domestic issues, but also the relationship to what happens foreign. The idea of structural adjustment didn't happen initially here. They began someplace else. The different ways in which people control people's, how people move and how they organize began someplace else. And understand that we have a lot of work to do, and it's going to challenge us, and our capacity to sustain ourselves is going to challenge us, and our capacity to be able to understand exactly what is happening, to be critically analytical about what is happening around us, and understand all those things are things to do. You know, we're going back when I was like 21 years old and thinking that we're gonna change the world in the moment, then I would have been in a big shape. But I understand now, because I was talking about working in city government, Julie. When I was talking to work in the city government when I was like 24, 25 years old, and also community development in model cities program in San Francisco. And I saw some of the very fascinating things happening about community engagement and democracy, grassroots, organic grassroots democracy happening. You know, this is what we have to begin to build. It's about building. And this is the opportunity for us to build. And understanding the contradictions that we face, understanding that all of those, and understanding the value of having a platform that's intersectional, that has a platform that talks about the environment, that talks about that. We're talking about the American dream. There was no discussion about the American dream in relationship to the environment and what destruction was done to the environment, you know. Something like over six since 1970, something like 60% of the wildlife in this world, this is what has just disappeared.
Yes, yes. Yes.
We're talking about the issues around those who are affected. We're talking about migration now and immigration now. What does migration and immigration look like when we have climate that reflected in climate change and everything else? We haven't even faced those realities then. And that reality is the reality we now face is propagated on people's fears, and also is expedited by these demagogues out here who talk about it, you know, and who become these pundits on it and everything else. But see, well, we have to understand that right there. And what do we mean by work? You know, what do we mean? What does work mean? You know, Jeremy Rifkin in his book, The End of Work, talked about wasn't the emancipation, the proclamation that freed African Americans from the land, it was the invention of the cotton machine. All of a sudden, at one point in time, 100% of the cotton beat by hand. Within 2 decades, the next 100% cotton by machine. Displacing a lot of families in African Americans, making them expendable. In the sense. So what do we about work. How do we talk about work in relationship and creating socially valuable, necessary work with its teachers? Thank you. Teachers is a proud profession. I'm proud of the LA teachers who are going on strike. They're about to go on strike. It's a proud profession. How do teachers, how do we do child care, all the things that are important to sustaining who we are, a building. The idea is not the idea as we had it, is what we have the commodity we able to acquire, but what kind of human beings are we capable of being? That's where the work has to come to. And that's the translation and transformation that we talked about in our revolution. Talk about transformation. A beautiful moment when we had this at the Sanders Institute Summit. We asked Jane, invited Bob Moses up. Robert Moses, Dr. Martin Luther King said of Robert Moses, he is a man who's not into self-engagement, self-indulgence or self-promotion. He's a man who's not into self-promotion. So we came to the event quietly, and I said, Jane went to introduce him, said he's in the audience. Bernie Sanders basically levitated out of his seat. He jumped up. I've never seen him move that fast. Bob Moses. They never met before. They both worked in the civil rights movement. Bob Moses, famous of Mississippi Summer, back in 1964, where they brought an incredible the voter action and training and bringing people down to Mississippi at that time. So we said they had a conversation for the first time. Bob started talking about education. He started talking about 21st century education versus 20th century education. He started talking about how sharecropper education as opposed to 21st century education. And one of the issues that they were dealing with in the South 50-something years ago was the issue around sharecropping education. That the right to vote was the standard there for citizenship. It was a ticket to citizenship, the right to vote in the 20th century. So they had freedom schools. They had different other things, preparing citizens to vote. He said, but the right to citizenship in the 21st century is not the right to vote, but the right to be able to equate algebra. Mm-hmm. Hey, 1% of the children in this country are prepared for 21st century education. So he says,
Is it on? Okay, I think it's on. So that video, that video that I just posted was Senator Nina Turner and Danny Glover speaking about the organization Our Revolution that I'm a board member of. And anyway, I just wanted to say that so that it didn't seem like some random video that was on here. That's all. I hope you're having a wonderful Sunday.